LNG is one of the world's fastest growing sources of energy. In 2023, according to the International Gas Union, the countries of the world imported over 400 million tons of LNG. The industry has been growing rapidly as of late, and this growth presents us with a cold opportunity. You see, once that LNG arrives at the terminal, we have to turn it back into a gas. The way we do it leaves us with a lot of cold energy. Today, most of it is used as a mere heatsink, but can it be more? In this video, I look at a strange and potentially underutilized resource, LNG cold energy. I briefly discussed natural gas in a prior video about Australia. Natural gas has been around for a while. We have been using it since the 1900s to light our stoves and heat up our homes. But the problem has always been getting the gas from the natural gas fields, which are often quite isolated, to the natural gas users, affordably and at scale. The vast majority of gas we send through pipelines. But for longer distances, LNG is more economical. After pre-treating the natural gas, meaning that we remove contaminants like hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide, mercury, sulfur, and other unwanted stuff, we cool the gas down to negative 162 degrees Celsius at atmospheric pressure, turning it into a liquid. This is an energy-intensive process done in large liquefaction plants, or more recently, offshore liquefaction facilities. The latter are basically huge boats equipped with what you need to process and liquefy the gas right on board. It makes it easier for gas fields located far offshore. When in a liquid form, the natural gas takes up to 600 times less volume, so we can pour it into these massive tanks made of special alloys and transport it via boat at an economical rate. LNG is colorless, odorless, and non-toxic, though I wouldn't recommend chugging it. It is also insoluble in water, so if we were to spill it, it simply evaporates with little cleanup necessary. As a liquid, it won't burn, but those vapors will, so take caution. Our story begins once the LNG tanker arrives and unloads its LNG stores at the terminal. The LNG arrives very cold. Before we can supply it to the customer, we need to add heat back into it, so to return it to a gaseous state, a process that we call regasification. What a funny word. Regasification is most frequently done by funneling the cold LNG through a machine called a vaporizer, no relation to vapes for nicotine, which then reheats the liquid to about 40 degrees Celsius. There are several types of vaporizers. A simple one to comprehend is the direct-fired vaporizer. These puppies use burners to heat up the LNG. We used them back in the 1960s and 1970s, but they're no longer as popular due to corrosion problems. Another is the submerged combustion vaporizer. In this contraption, we run pipes of cold LNG through hot water, heated up with hot bubbles of hot air. Hot. The amount of heat energy that the submerged combustion vaporizer needs for regasification is equivalent to about 1.5% of the LNG's energy capacity. So we burn about 1.5% of the LNG to heat up the rest. When you count in the fact that we lose some amount more from boil-off during the boat ride over to the terminal, the loss can be considered high. Submerged combustion vaporizers are easy to build and are widely used in the United States, but operators often grapple with the problem of the hot bubbles acidifying the water and causing corrosion in the pipes. A third type of vaporizer, if location allows, as in the surrounding seawater is warmer than 5 degrees Celsius, we can use an open rack vaporizer. It pumps up warmer seawater and then runs pipes of cold LNG through it. No matter how we do this heat exchange between the LNG and the warmer water or whatever, after the LNG exchanges its quote-unquote coldness, it's turned back into a natural gas. We can then pipe it over to the consumers or burn it as a low-carbon fossil fuel to spin a turbine, you do you. Something else that comes out alongside the gasified natural gas is cold energy. Cold energy that is quite cold, about negative 15 degrees Celsius, and in a rather large volume, maybe even thousands of tons of liquid worth. What do we do with it? Most facilities simply use it as a heat sink for their other equipment, or they run it through an air conditioning system, fridge, or some other cooling system. That's pretty practical. Imagine if we can use this for cooling some big AI data centers. Though the problem with those use cases is that LNG terminals are not often geographically close to those places, leaving us with only so many things to chill. So most of the time, the cold just goes away, which is sad. After all, we use a lot of energy at the start to chill the gas, about 2,500 to 3,500 kilojoules per kilogram. Then we spent energy to reheat the LNG again, up to 1.5% of the total LNG we carried over. Once all that's done, we just discard the cold energy like trash. So the idea is that we leverage the energy gap between the coldness and the warmer environment to perform a little bit of work. The energy we spent liquefying the natural gas can be reharvested. Estimates of this exergy, as it is so called, imply that we can get back about 800 to 1,000 kilojoules per kilogram of LNG, so a little less than half of what we put into it. But what can we use it for? The most common use case for LNG cold energy is for power generation. One interesting concept is called direct expansion, which integrates into the larger LNG regasification system. First, we pump the LNG at high pressure into the vaporizer to regasify it. As the LNG returns to a gaseous state, it expands, taking up volume. However, the high pressure keeps it compressed. We then run this compressed natural gas through a turbine to generate electricity. Unfortunately, just doing the direct expansion cycle by itself is not enough to really make the most of the cold energy's potential here. There is some efficiency loss here due to the heater. So they refined this into what we call the Rankine cycle, a system that operates similarly to most power plants. The Rankine cycle generates power by continuously evaporating and condensing some working liquid back and forth. This can be water, but in recent times we have looked at other liquids with lower boiling points, like propane. Such cases are called organic Rankine cycles. Anyway, whatever the working liquid is, we start by heating it so to turn it into steam. As the steam expands, it runs through a turbine and turns it to generate electricity. And after that, the steam is cooled so that it can condense back into a liquid form so that we can pump it back into the heater and get the party started all over again. We can chain cycles together in a cascading fashion to get more mileage out of our buck. Studies have shown that a three-stage cycle works quite well. The Rankine cycle makes the most sense when employed in places where we have a lot of waste heat to work with. It's basically a way to earn a little extra money with this otherwise low-grade heat. So it integrates quite well with LNG energy generation, where we have both waste heat and waste cold together in one place. Other than energy generation, what seems to be the most commonly used application is air separation. The name is pretty clear on what this is about. We separate normal air into its individual chemical components like nitrogen or oxygen using cold temperatures of around negative 196 degrees Celsius. Normally, the process requires a significant amount of electricity to refrigerate the air to such a cold temperature, so introducing LNG cold energy can help save on those costs by an estimated 40 to 55%. One issue, however, is economic. The demand for liquid air components like nitrogen or oxygen is not particularly high. Considering the not insignificant capital expenditures involved, it could take some time to pay back those investments. Another use case in a similar line is cryogenic carbon dioxide capture. When you burn natural gas, you're left with an exhaust, a flue gas containing carbon dioxide. Natural gas burns rather cleanly from the get-go, but you can further reduce the amount of carbon dioxide by cooling the flue gas to below carbon dioxide's dew point. The CO2 separates out and liquefies. This requires refrigeration and thus electricity. Again, introducing LNG cold energy can help make the process more efficient. In some cases, the carbon dioxide removal can be as high as 100%, giving us a process that some might call carbon neutral. Another application that makes a lot of sense and hits close to my heart is desalination. Previous videos of mine have covered other desalination methods, most of which work by either pushing water through a filter or heating it up into a steam. How can we integrate cold energy into that? There are two broad ideas, one easier than the other. The easy method integrates the use of this cold into thermal-dependent methods like the massive multi-stage flash desalination complexes they have in the Middle East. Those facilities work by first flash evaporating seawater using high thermal energy in low atmospheric pressure conditions before then condensing that steam back into fresh water. We could use the LNG's coldness in that second step, basically as a heat sink for pulling the thermal energy back out of the separated water vapor, turning it back into something potable. This method is conceptually simple and it works at scale, but I do want to say that heating up water this way is really only economical when we have tremendous amounts of cheap heat energy at our disposal, so it's not widely adopted and thus not applicable to everyone. The second cold desalination method is a little more complex but holds a great deal more potential. It's called seawater freezing desalination, and it uses cold energy to freeze seawater into an ice slurry. We then, and this is the hard part, separate the ice particles from the slurry and wash it so that we can then turn the ice particles into fresh water. As I just mentioned, this process is a bit more complicated engineering-wise. For example, ice crystals forming on the surface of the heat exchangers can impede the transfer process, and the resulting fresh water is still a bit salty since we cannot yet rinse all the salt off the ice chunks. But since freezing uses about a seventh of the thermal energy used to evaporate seawater, this second process is more energy efficient. Yes, maybe even more energy efficient than the widely adopted reverse osmosis desalination method. It might even make sense to chain the two processes together to get the best of both worlds. The concept of LNG cold energy is a bit weird, and the first thing I thought to myself was, well, is anyone actually using this? Turns out several countries in Asia indeed are, with Japan, as usual, at the forefront of this utilization. 29% of the country's energy generation mix today comes via natural gas, so Japan is one of the world's largest importers of LNG. One of the biggest companies there in that space is Osaka Gas, which supplies much of the natural gas for the Kansai region, an area of about 24 million people, including Kyoto, Osaka, and the like. In the 1970s, Osaka Gas built the massive Senboku LNG terminal to receive much of the company's LNG overseas imports. Over the years, they have expanded it into a major industrial center, exploring new uses of LNG and sharing costs at scale. In 1977, they started air separation production using cold LNG energy, producing liquefied argon, nitrogen, and oxygen to sell through their Cold Air Products subsidiary. In 1979, they began generating power using LNG cold energy and an organic Rankine cycle based on propane, reporting that they were able to generate some 1,450 kilowatts with it. The success of Osaka Gas and other such companies in Japan have incentivized other countries to adopt the same, many of them in Asia, where the majority of LNG growth has come from in recent years. Most of them are using it for air separation. For example, the massive Maptaput LNG terminal in Thailand seems to use it for air separation and liquefaction. But other interesting use cases are emerging too. Recent papers detail how the big LNG terminal in Ningbo, China, uses LNG cold energy to store fish products and other perishables. So how much cold energy is there potentially for us to use? A lot, actually. Go back to the numbers we talked about earlier. Assuming that each kilogram of LNG converts into an average value of about 800 kilojoules, 400 million tons leaves you with something like 300,000 petajoules of possible work. Of course, relevant assumptions apply. The conversion to energy is not 100% efficient, different needs have different efficiency, so on. My main point, though, is that as this industry continues to scale and eat other forms of carbon energy, the LNG cold energy opportunity will grow too. Yes, so far it feels like the use cases for this energy are rather sparse. It is, after all, waste cold. But that might change down the line. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the newsletter, and I'll see you guys next time.